Go ahead and take a seat, and as you're doing so, take your Bibles or your apps, whatever you read the Bible on, and I want you to turn to Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23. If you don't have a Bible, we've got some Bibles under some of the chairs. Feel free to grab one. Luke is about two-thirds of the way through the Bible. Look in your table of contents if you need that. There's no shame in that. So feel free to do that. If you don't have a Bible at home, grab one of those Bibles under the chairs and take that home with you, because we want every person to have a Bible at their house that they can read, that they can refer to and look to, that they can hear a message here at Calvary and then go home and make sure that what we say is what the Bible says. So please feel free to do that. Now, as you're turning to Luke chapter 23, I've got a question for you. If you knew what your last day was going to be on this earth, what would you choose as your last meal? Turn to your neighbor and talk about that for a second. What would your last meal be? Okay, so it's already been said, but how many of you said steak? That gets the most responses, I think, of the two services. This is the third one that we've done this weekend. That gets the most responses. How many said like a hamburger or a cheeseburger, something along those lines? Okay, a few of you. How many of you said pancakes? Okay, one more besides me. Finally, I've been through three services, and there's the first person that has agreed with me that pancakes would be your last meal. Maybe I'm childish or something, I don't know, but I would choose pancakes. I love pancakes. Now, it's interesting to think about what your last meal may be if you knew the day, but let me shift this a little more serious. If you knew what your last day was going to be, what would you tell your loved ones? What would you want your loved ones to make sure that they heard from you, that they understood from you before you passed? What do you think that would be? That's an interesting one to think about, isn't it? Because let's face it, we kind of take our conversations with people for granted, don't we? Like, I'll talk to my brother on the phone, and I hang up the phone with the assumption that I'm going to talk to him sometime later on down the road. But if you knew your last day, that would be different, wouldn't it? Well, we're starting a brand new series today called Last Words. And over the next 6 weeks, we're going to look at the things that Jesus said while he hung on the cross. Because he made a set of statements, and knowing that he was dying on the cross, he made some very interesting statements. And so we're going to look at those. And over the next 6 weeks, it's going to lead us into Easter. Of course, the season, the day when we celebrate Jesus Christ's death and resurrection from the cross. And so that's where it's going to lead us. So we're going to look at the first statement today, and it's in Luke 23, verse 34. Luke 23, verse 34. And it says this: "And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Pretty powerful statement, isn't it? I mean, think about, let me do the background here for just a second. In the previous week, before Jesus makes this statement, in that previous week, he has triumphantly entered into Jerusalem. I mean, so much so that people laid palm branches and laid their coats on the road where he was walking, and they worshiped Jesus as the Messiah. Okay? And then he spent the week teaching at the temple, doing miracles, doing some really amazing things. And then the night before he makes this statement, he eats a meal, the Passover meal, with his disciples. And in that meal, Judas is revealed as the betrayer. He washes the disciples' feet. He says some pretty cool stuff. He gives us the act of communion to do in remembrance of him, which we're going to do later on this morning. And then he leaves that meal and he goes off to the Garden of Gethsemane, where he prays some pretty difficult and heartfelt prayers. And then he's betrayed. He's beaten, and according to historical records outside of the Bible, we know that there were many people who went through the beating that Jesus went through and did not survive. I mean, that beating was severe. The Bible tells us that the beating was so bad that most of the people around Jesus did not recognize him because he was so beat up. And then he is forced to carry his cross all the way through the city of Jerusalem while people spit on him and mock him and humiliate him and call him names. And then ultimately they take him to the hill, they lay him down on his cross, they drive nails into his hands and his feet, and he hangs on that cross for hours. And yet he makes this statement, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I don't know about you, but if I had experienced what Jesus had just experienced, I would not have made that statement. Would you? It'd be hard. It'd be hard to make this statement. So we're going to spend the morning talking about forgiveness. Because as a follower of Christ, we're called to be more like him. And let's face it, I don't think there's anybody in this room that would have made this statement. So let's see what Jesus' heart on forgiveness is. So the first thing that I want you to understand about forgiveness is this. Forgiveness is foundational. Forgiveness is foundational. I mean, we're in a series about Jesus' statements while he hung and died on a cross. And think about it for a second. As a follower of Christ, if you're a follower of Christ in this room, what's one of the best things about Jesus' death on the cross? It's that his blood cleanses us and forgives us of our sins, right? I mean, the whole message of the cross is forgiveness at its core. And so the fact that we're talking about forgiveness being foundational really goes way beyond just an idea that we have about what we should do. The message of the entire cross is forgiveness, isn't it? And so we need to understand forgiveness in a big way. I mean, think about it for a second. I've alluded to this, but Jesus Christ was the Son, is the Son of God, the second person of the Trinity. And he left perfection. He left heaven to come to this earth, live 33-ish years, and then at the end of his life be tortured and hung on a cross so that his blood could be shed for our sins as the ultimate sacrifice to forgive us so that we wouldn't inherit hell, which we deserve, but that we would inherit heaven because of his forgiveness and grace. You sitting in this room today, me standing on this stage, if you have a relationship with Christ, you're forgiven because of the cross. If you're sitting in this room and you've never stepped into a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ, and you go, you know what? I want to be forgiven of my sins. I want to take that step and accept Jesus into my life so that I can be cleansed of my sins and go to heaven, then we want to help facilitate that for you. So if you're sitting here today and you want to make that decision, at the end of the service, we're going to have our prayer team up here in the front. We'll have pastors and leaders out in the Connection Center. Come talk to someone. Let us talk to you about what it looks like, what it means to step into a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. Because everyone can be forgiven. That's the message of the cross. So forgiveness is foundational to everything that we as followers of Christ believe. But it's not just foundational because of that. It's also foundational because Jesus commanded it. Just in the way that we treat people, Jesus calls us to forgive. So let me give you some examples of this. In Matthew 22, a scribe comes up to Jesus and he says, "Jesus, what's the greatest commandment in all of God's word?" And Jesus says this, "The first one is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength." And he says, "The second one is like it. It's love your neighbor as yourself." And so if Jesus says that the second greatest commandment in all of God's word is love your neighbor as yourself, we should forgive our neighbors. Because forgiveness is part of love. Think about Matthew chapter 7. In Matthew 7, he gives us the golden rule. do to others as you would have them do to you. Now, I don't know about you, but when I mess up or I hurt someone or I sin against someone, I hope that that person will forgive me, don't you? So if we're supposed to treat others the way we would hope to be treated, then we need to be willing to forgive people. Matthew 5 takes it even a step further. In Matthew 5, he's doing the Sermon on the Mount, and Jesus says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. So it's not just people that we like that we're supposed to be forgiving. It's even the people we don't like. And so Jesus commands it. It's foundational, but here's the difficulty here. Do we live in a society where forgiveness is necessarily the golden rule, where people, do we live in a society where forgiveness is the norm? No. I mean, anybody who's on social media knows that the norm is actually conflict, isn't it? People long to be in conflict. If you're not in some kind of conflict, you're not cool. We live in a society today where it's fashionable, it's considered good to be offended by every little thing. It's fashionable to take a stand and get offended and push people away from you because of the offense, right? That's kind of the culture that has begun to develop here in the United States. So it's not exactly a place where forgiveness is easy, because no one around us is encouraging us to forgive either. And so we have to counteract, we have to push against what culture is teaching us. We have to look at culture and say, I don't want my life to be about unforgiveness and fighting and conflicts and quarrels. I want my life to be about mercy and grace, because that's how God treats me. But it's hard. Let's be honest. It's not easy. So forgiveness must be the foundation that we live our life by, that we live our life on. It has to be foundational. And here's why. Forgiven people forgive people. Forgiven people forgive people. In other words, you, as a follower of Christ, you are a forgiven person, and therefore you should go and forgive other people. I, as a forgiven person, should go and forgive others. This is why we forgive, because he forgave us. Let's face it, every one of us in this room sin on a daily basis, don't we? Let's be really honest. Most of us in this room sin on an hourly basis, don't we? We absolutely do. We are sinful people. And yet, when we mess up a dozen times in a day, or two dozen times in a day, and we go to God over and over through our day, and we say, God, I messed up again. Please forgive me and help me not to do that again. What does God do? He forgives, doesn't he? You see, you, me, as a follower of Christ, we are forgiven. And so therefore, we should be more than willing to go out and forgive. He forgives us so we can forgive others. But not only that, Jesus takes it a step further in Matthew 6. In Matthew 6, he gives us the Lord's Prayer. And the two verses right after the Lord's Prayer is Matthew 6, 14 and 15. And he says this, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. That's pretty heavy. In other words, God is saying, guys, I forgive you hundreds of times in a given month. The least you should do is go and forgive others the one or two times that they sin against you. Now, on a side note, if you are living in unforgiveness and you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, this verse, Matthew 6, 14 and 15, doesn't mean that you're losing your salvation. It just means that that's your sin issue that you need to go and get help with, that you need to work on, that you need to put ways in your life to get through that sin issue and live in unforgiveness, live in forgiveness rather than unforgiveness. And so we're called to forgive no matter the circumstances. And not only that, We're called to forgive with no stipulations. So here's the question. If a person never actually asks for your forgiveness, are you still supposed to forgive them? Yes. And you may say, well, where is that in the Bible? It's in the verse we're looking at today, Luke 23, 34. Did the Sadducees and Pharisees and the Roman soldiers that hung Jesus on that cross, did they look at Jesus as he's hanging there and go, oh, Jesus, forgive us, we messed up. And then Jesus said this statement? That's not how it played out. The Pharisees, the religious leaders that falsely accused Jesus as an innocent man, they never asked for Jesus' forgiveness, but did he forgive them? Yeah. So whether someone asks you, forgive me or not, it doesn't matter. You as a follower of Christ are called to still forgive no matter what the offense, no matter whether they ask or not, no matter what the circumstances are, you're called, I'm called to forgive. Now, I want to make something very clear here, though. I'm asking you, I'm telling you that the Bible tells you to forgive people. I'm not telling you to forget. Because first off, forgetting is not actually physically possible. Our brains are wired too well. God made our brains too good to just forget when someone offends us or hurts us or sins against us. So it's not actually possible to forget. But we can learn from it. So let me give you an example. If someone comes to your house repeatedly and steals from you repeatedly, you have the capacity to forgive that person every time they steal from you. But does that necessarily mean that you're going to keep inviting them to your house? Not necessarily. Or if you do invite them to your house, maybe you watch them like an eagle to make sure that they don't fall into that sin again. In other words, you can forgive while at the same time learning and putting up the proper boundaries so that that sin does not continue to happen to you. So I'm not saying to forget. I'm saying to forgive and learn. Now, this leads us to the big question this morning. And the big question is this: how do you forgive? Because I can stand up here all day long and tell you, you need to forgive. Jesus commands it. Jesus exemplifies it. Jesus did it. But it's a whole other thing to actually apply that, isn't it? Forgiveness can, in some instances, be a difficult thing. And so here's where I'm going with this. Forgiveness takes a choice and change. Forgiveness takes choice and change. Now, let me be blunt, because I haven't been blunt up to this point. Let me be blunt with this. I believe, as a pastor and a licensed counselor, that we have made forgiveness much more complicated than God actually designed it to be. So let me give you an example. My wife and I own a 2010 Nissan Altima. And if you know Nissans, they have the push-button start. There's no little slot to stick a key and turn the ignition. It's the first car I've had like that. So let me paint a scenario for you. Let's say that I go to the dealership and we're looking at this car and I sit down in the driver's seat and I look at the dashboard and I don't see an ignition hole to stick my key and turn. And so I look at the dealer and I say, how do I start the vehicle? And he explains, oh, there's the fob that you have in your pocket sends a signal to the car and you just press the button and it starts up and blah, blah, blah. Do I then sit in that vehicle after hearing the dealer explain to me how to start the car? Do I sit in that vehicle and go, oh my gosh, should I push the button or should I don't know? This is different than everything I've been. It's hard and I don't know what to do. Do I do that? No, I press the button and I start the car and I go, because it's simple. It's easy. You push the button. We, as United States of America citizens in 2017, have made forgiveness way more complicated than it actually is, because God made it so simple. But we, when we feel hurt, when we feel betrayed, when we feel like somebody has sinned against us, we go in this introspective, emotional, oh my gosh, I don't know if I should forgive them, and what if they do it into this and that, and we freak out over nothing. Because does God say, when you go to him and ask him to forgive you, does he go, oh, I don't know. I don't know if I should forgive you, because you know what? I know the future, and you're just going to commit that sin again tomorrow. Does God do that to you or me? No, he doesn't. When you or I go to God and say, God, I've sinned, forgive me. What does God do? Bam, you're forgiven. It's simple. It's like pushing a button. He doesn't want you to have this big emotional introspective struggle inside of you. He wants you to just forgive and move on. It's easy. Quit making it so complicated. And let me be really, really blunt here, because I haven't been up to this point. If you struggle consistently with forgiving the people around you, go talk to someone. Go find a pastor or a counselor that you trust, or a Christian that you have in your life that you really look to and go, yeah, that person really has an amazing walk with Christ, and I could learn from them. Go talk to someone about what it looks like to forgive, and let them walk with you and help you to be a forgiving person. Because at its core, unforgiveness is pure selfishness. It's us going, you know what? I don't care if God has forgiven me 2,000 times in the past 5 months. That person offended me, and I'm done with them, and I'm not going to forgive them. That, at its core, is one of the most selfish things that we can do as human beings, as followers of Christ. So if you, as a follower of Christ, struggle with unforgiveness, if you struggle with forgiving the people in your life, go get some help. Go talk to someone, because this is not a minor little spiritual issue. This is a big spiritual issue. It's the foundation of everything that we as Christians believe. So I said that forgiveness takes choice and change. So here's the choice. It's the choice to let go. The choice to let go. Let go of the anger and the bitterness. Let's face it. Every one of us in this room, when we get betrayed or we are sinned against or we're hurt by someone, we get angry, don't we? And rightly so. And there's not a sin in getting angry about that. It's how we respond to that emotion of anger. If you continue to live in that anger and you continue to let that anger just boil inside of you, you're never going to be led into forgiveness, are you? So you have to, at some point, say, I recognize this anger that I'm struggling with, and I'm going to let it go because it's not healthy for me and it's not what God would want me to do. And so we have to let go of the angerness, we let go of the bitterness, but we also have to let go of thinking about the offense. Because what do? All too many times? Someone betrays us, and what do? We replay that betrayal in our mind over and over and over and over. And what does that do to our attitude towards that person? It makes them a demon in our eyes. It makes them the enemy. They're the great betrayer of our life, and we cannot forgive them at that point because we've painted them as this horrible, evil person. But in Philippians chapter 4, the Bible tells us that we're not supposed to dwell on the evil and the bad and the negative and the sin. We're supposed to dwell on things that are noble and things that are excellent and things that are worthy and things that are of good reputation and those kinds of things. And so we need to let go of the actual betrayal, the actual event, and change. Now, there are a couple of lies that I want to address in this, because you have to choose not to believe these lies. And the first lie is this. We tell ourselves, well, you don't know what they did to me. You don't know how bad this sin was. You can't tell me to just go and forgive this person. You don't know how bad it was. Let me just put it out there, black and white. Jesus was betrayed, even though he did nothing wrong, was beaten to the point of almost death, made to carry a cross through town in humiliation and ridicule, and then hung on a cross for hours to die. How many of you have been put through something like that? Yeah, suck it up, people. It's time that we forgive, and if you believe the lie, well, you don't know what they did to me, then you need to stop telling yourself that lie, because Jesus went through more than any one of us in this room will ever experience, and so we need to forgive because he forgave. The second lie is this: well, they don't deserve to be forgiven. You know, they've committed this offense many times, and so this time they don't deserve it. Well, the truth is, neither do you. Oh, sorry. You don't deserve, I don't deserve to be forgiven, but does Jesus forgive us? All day long he does. And so the fact is that we have to realize it doesn't matter how many times or what the offense is that someone has done to us, Jesus forgives us over and over and over and over and over and over and over again. And so we forgive over and over and over and over again. It doesn't matter what they've done. It doesn't matter how many times they've done it. We forgive because he forgives. Period, end of story. We don't deserve his forgiveness, but we still forgive everyone else because we're just as unworthy. Now, I said that we have a choice, that it's a choice to let go, but there's also a change of heart. A change of heart. We need to change our heart, our attitude, our approach to everything in life. Because think about it for just a moment. Rather than seeking revenge or trying to get one up on that person or saying, oh yeah, well, I'm going to do this. What if instead of having that attitude when someone offends us or hurts us or sins against us, rather than having that attitude, what if we said, you know what? It hurt me. It damaged me. It betrayed me. I need to heal, but to do that, I'm going to pray. Instead of getting even, I'm going to pray for that person. How do you think your attitude toward a person is going to change if you, instead of dwelling on the negative about that person and what they've done to you, instead, if you sat down and daily prayed for them and said, God, help them to come to know you more. Help me to heal from this. Help me to maybe lead them to a life-changing relationship with Jesus Christ. How would your view of that person change if you prayed for them daily? They wouldn't be the demon that you thought they were before. They wouldn't be the evil, crazy lunatic that you thought they were before. You would see them through the eyes that Jesus Christ sees them, as a person in need of a Savior, in need of forgiveness, in need of healing. Because God can redeem everything. And this change of heart needs to be continual. It needs to be everlasting. Because think about it, Peter goes up to Jesus one day and says, Jesus, how many times should I forgive my brother? Seven times? And Jesus goes, you're funny. Not seven, but seven times 70. Now, don't sit there and crunch the numbers and give a limit to how many times you're going to forgive your brother based off of seven times 70. Jesus is playing a numbers game that was actually common in biblical times. Playing those two numbers together meant infinite. It meant it never ended. It was ongoing. And so our forgiveness to other people should be continual and ongoing through that change of heart that we have. Let me put it in this perspective. How would your life be different in your relationship with Christ if Christ said, oh, hey, by the way, you only have 490 times that I'm going to forgive you? What if God put a limit on how many times he forgave you? Ho, ho, ho. There would be some of us in this room going, God, take me now. I'm almost to my limit. Right? But does God put a limit on how many times he's going to forgive us? No. So we, in return, should not put a limit on how many times we forgive our brothers and sisters. Forgiveness is continual. It keeps going. So, I have a question, a challenge for you. And here's the question part. how would your life change? How would your relationships change with friends, family, spouse, children, coworkers? How would your life change if you, right here, sitting in your seat, said, you know what? The Bible's right. I'm going to start being a person that forgives. How would your life change if because you took the step to be a forgiving person, the people around you went, wow, that was really cool. Because they were forgiving, you know what? That challenged me and convicted me that I need to be forgiving as well. What if, how would your life change if you forgave and the people around you forgave as well? Would your life improve for the better? Yeah, it would. Relationships could be fixed. Friendships could be redeemed. Children would talk to parents again and vice versa. If we decided to forgive, how would this community change if just the people sitting in this room right now decided, you know what? The Bible's right. I'm going to start forgiving. And I don't care what the circumstances are. I don't care who or what or how or why. I'm just going to forgive because Jesus forgives me that way. How would Lake Havasu City change if just the 300 to 400 people, 400 to 5, I don't know how many people are in here, how would Lake Havasu change if just you sitting in this room committed to be a forgiving person? This community would be completely revolutionized. And that's my challenge, is for you today, right where you're sitting, to make the conscious choice to stop making it so complicated and just forgive the way Jesus forgives you. Join me in prayer.